been a lovely afternoon, lovely Lord's Day, and what a wonderful way to spend a late winter evening together here as we listen to Community Alliance Church's quartet, the WKSD men, as they present Home Sweet Home.
With all my heart and soul, I'll never more be the same. The something we've been looking forward to for a long time. And we just hope that you relax and have a good time, because we're going to relax, at least folks keep telling y'all, just relax. But they're not up here. But we're going to have a good time, and we're going to sing some things that you know and some that you don't know, and maybe some you don't even like. I don't know. But we're going to have a good time. Let me introduce ourselves real quick. Just for those that don't know who we are, my name's Dennis. My life's work is involved in numbers. Winberg is next door to me, and his life's work is involved with woodworking. Mr. Steve Russell next door to me, his life's work is involved with computing. And Mr. Ken Preisitz is over on the other end, and his life's work is... his life's work is hunting and fishing. And boating and skiing. And when he runs out of money, he sells insurance. The lady over there on the piano is a gracious lady, and one that we couldn't do without and can't say enough for. But Carol, we appreciate you. That you put up for us. An old hymn of the church, I'm sure you're familiar with, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. Mary Lou, this is for you, very good.
I'll be silent.
Carol told me a while ago, she said, I've got to have some time right after you sing Jump the Closer Walk with Thee to get some music put together. So I'll share something with you. We heard the other night we went up to Du Bois to sing for them up there, and some of our denominational leaders were up there, and Morris Irvin, who's the editor of the Alliance Life, got up and he told a story about a man that had a little mole right here on his chin. And it was beginning to bother him, so he decided that he'd go to the doctor and have the doctor look at it. So he called down an appointment and showed up at the appointed time and told the receptionist that he was there. And she said, you go back and see that nurse right back there. So he did. He said, you know, I've got this little mole. I want the doctor to look at it. And the nurse said, you go back, you walk down this hall, first door, the last door to the right, take off all your clothes and wait on the doctor. He said, but you don't understand, it's just a little mole right here. She said, what I want you to do, sir, is walk down this aisle, this hall, last door on the right, go and take off all your clothes and the doctor will come in and see you. He said, but you don't understand. You see, it's just a little mole right here. Why do I? She said, I told you. You walk down that hall right there and take the last door to the right, take off all your clothes and doctor will be in. He said, okay. So he did just exactly what he said. When he got in there, there was already a fellow sitting in there without a stitch of clothes on, sitting there in a chair. And this guy said, boy, that was one tough lady. Another fellow says, you're telling me all I was trying to do was deliver a UPS package. Marty, I thought of you when I heard that joke. Okay, this is one that it moves real quick. If you want to clap your hands, that's fine with us. It's called I'm on the Battlefield for My Lord. In this church 8 years ago, and I didn't realize it's been that long. Connie really, I just maybe as an offhand way, had a way of bringing us together. I've been in this church maybe 2-3 weeks in January of 1984, And Ken, I had met Ken, and he said, "Hey, I'm going over to practice with Win Rarick." And I didn't know who Win Rarick was, and he said, "Why don't you come with me?" So he came by and got me, and we went over to Connie's house. And from that, we got together with Steve, and we've been singing ever since. But Connie, thank you so much for coming, and I'd like you all to listen now as Connie and Carol play for us. Thank you. Such a dear friend of ours, and he's really a good friend to a quartet that doesn't have any sound system. And all the stuff you see belongs to him. And Bob, we just thank you so much for giving him your time and for helping us tonight. You know, when we practice at Jesus over Stephen Carroll's house, and their girls are always around our feet and having a good time. As a matter of fact, Stacy, their oldest daughter, knows these songs better than KP does. When he misses a word, she'd say, you missed that word. So she's got them all. And we're used to singing around kids. And so we thought, you know, one of the things we'd like to do tonight is to do some stuff with the kids. So if you're a kid, we've got something we want to give you, but you're going to have to come down here to get it. So with all kids, just come on down, and we've got some lollipops for you. Come on. Right now is a good time to be coming. If you qualify for a kid, but you're going to have to sit down right here and listen.
You can.
Sit down right here on the floor. Lord, now let me hear. Get some lollipops right over here, guys. But wait, don't open them. Whew, I about got in trouble on that one. Don't open them until after we get through singing, okay? Because we've got some singing, and you guys are going to help us do some stuff. But I can't believe we got these two big guys up here. Listen, lollipops right over here.
Be sad with our kids when you come. When you come to the end of a lollipop, to the end of a lollipop, when you come to the end of a lollipop, plop goes your heart. Gilly, oh golly, go, I love my lolly, oh, night to the very last lick. But when you are through with it, what do you do with it? All you have left is the stick. When you come to the end of a lollipop, to the end of a lollipop, when you come to the end of a lollipop, plop goes your heart. Gilly, oh golly, oh, I love my lolly, oh, winter and summer and spring. But when you are done, it's about as much fun as a yo-yo without any string. When you come to the end of a lollipop, to the end of a lollipop, when you come to the end of a lollipop, plop goes your heart, plop.
Well now, weren't they cute? Those guys. I bet you think that was out of character for those guys, but you know, whenever they show up to our house to practice, that's exactly how they're dressed, handing out lollipops. That's not true, is it, Stacy? They never give us lollipops. Well, what did we learn about lollipops? They don't last very long, do they? No, they're real fun for a little while, and then they're gone. That's true about a lot of things, isn't it? Can you think of something else that is good, but not for long, it's gone? Maybe a chocolate Easter bunny? Or a coming bedroom? A hot bath? But you know what isn't like that? God's love. That's what we want to talk about. God's love for you and for me. That's right. God's love never runs out. God loves us so much that he sent Jesus to live and die for you and for me. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Wow, eternal life. Not only does God's love go on and on forever, but so will you and I if we truly believe in Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior. Let's sing some songs about that love. Stacy and Stephanie, can you come help us sing? Sing a song about how big is God's love. God's love is so high, you can't get over it. So low, you can't get under it. So wide, you can't get around it. You gotta go through the door. Oh, boy. Give me some music.
Bring it to Christ.
Your sins confessed.
On the Yeah.
Now, I was reading an article in the newspaper the other day, or maybe it was a magazine, and an interviewer was asking an elderly man, he said, "Have you lived all your life in Vermont?" And the fellow's answer was, "Well, not yet." So, you know, sometimes when we think about living, we don't think about dying. We just think we're going to keep on going. As a matter of fact, there was a story about a preacher who asked his congregation, said, "I mean, if you all want to go to heaven," well, everybody raised their hand except one fellow sitting on the front row. And the priest thought, "Well, maybe he just didn't understand." So I'll ask again. He said, "How many of you people want to go to heaven?" Well, everybody raised their hand except this one fellow. And he said, "Excuse me, sir, don't you want to go to heaven when you die?" And the guy said, "Oh, yeah, when I die, but I thought you were getting up and proud for right now." So that's all that to say this. You know, eventually we're all going to die. And those of us that have accepted Jesus Christ in our heart have that promise of heaven, don't we? And tonight, we hope that we maybe brought you a little bit closer to heaven. The last part of our program is going to be strictly on heaven. Our song's going to be on heaven. All the music. We just hope that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, that tonight, that you will ask Him into your heart. It is by simple faith that we ask Him, and Jesus Christ will come into our heart, and then you too would have that promise of heaven. Listen now as we sing. everybody got one, or at least access to one? If you don't, we've got some guys at the back that will be glad to give you one. If you need one of these sheets, would you please raise your hand so we can make sure you got one, please? We have some hymns on here that we thought would be good if you would help us sing. These are great old hymns of the church that I'm sure that you know. If you don't, you just kind of hum along. And you got the words, just whatever you want to do. But would you please join us as we sing, He the Pearly Gates Were Open, New Lord, Mansion Over the Hilltop, and We See Christ, when we all get to heaven. We'll lead you in. Ready?
Lord, do Lord, do remember me. When
We have a couple of special friends that have agreed to share with us tonight. Mr. Larry Hallback will be coming in just a moment and presenting his testimony. Larry is one of the elders in this church, one of the fine young men that we have. And I'm sure that he's going to bless you as he comes to give his personal testimony. But before he comes, Lisa Hall is going to come to sing. She really needs no introduction to you. She's a lady that travels with us some and helps us. And matter of fact, before she starts down with us, she couldn't sing a lick. We can tell her all she knows.
Or entered into the treasures of the snow. And I'm sure when we say snow tonight, there are probably groans about ready to filter through the audience here, because we've all seen our fill of snow for this year in 93 and 94. Kind of reminds me of the picture I saw in the newspaper a few weeks ago. A gentleman had piled a huge pile of snow in his front yard and put a sign on top that said, "Snow for sale." But you know, in the scriptures, snow is a symbol of purity, a symbol of cleansing, a symbol of cleanliness. As a matter of fact, Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18 says, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow." When I was asked to give my testimony tonight, I thought I would use those verses to use as a fulcrum to go right into my testimony. In 1978, I was a senior at Mars High School preparing to graduate, and through some various circumstances that spring, I met a young lady from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. She was up in Butler with a friend of hers, and they were scoping out Slippery Rock University. But this young lady, who I happened to meet, we began to write back and forth and began to date through the mail. And then through the summertime, she had come up and we began to date and to go out while she was up here for a few weeks. This young lady happened to be a Christian. In 1978, I didn't know the Lord. I had not grown up in a church family, a Christian family. I attended church maybe one time in the Boy Scouts. But yet, through her witness, she talked about going to church, talked about the Bible and these other things, and they went right over my head. As a matter of fact, that summer after she was here and she went back to Philadelphia, she said that she was going to a Bible or a religious college. My friends knew this, and they used to razz me a lot about that. And the only thing I could think of, again, I didn't know anything about church, but the only thing I could think of was, man, I'm dating a nun. I had no idea that a woman could go to Bible college and actually study and not be a nun. That's my only thought. Nevertheless, our relationship didn't prosper very much longer. I realized that really she wasn't the one for me. She was just too religious. We broke up later that year, but yet through her witness, the Lord used her to begin the process of work of salvation in my life. It was about a year later, in the fall of 1979, my mother began going to a Bible preaching church here in Butler. She had made a profession of faith when she was young, but through our lifetime and through our family, she had never really attended a church and had not been a firm commitment for the Lord. But yet, in 1979, she recommitted herself to the Lord. She began going to church and really tried to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. My brothers and I, who were still at home, and my father, we thought, hey, that's great. Mom should go to church. For the guys, well, we don't have time for that right now. I was going to Penn State University at the time, and I began to have some questions in my life after graduating from high school and getting ready to go into the future, to make my way in society. Some of the questions I had were, what will happen when I die? What is the purpose of life? Is it all there is to do? Go to university, graduate, get a degree, have a family, whatever. Go through life and then die. Is that all there is to it? What about the events of the world at that time? And there were some things, if you remember, the Soviets had invaded Afghanistan and some other things that were kind of unsettling to me. And so I began to ask these questions. And I remember in January, in 1980, I came in one Saturday night, and I told my mom, I said, I'm going to go to church with you tomorrow. And she about fell over backwards. You're going to go to church with me? And I said, I'll listen and see what there is. And I had never read the Bible before in my entire life. I think I did try once in Genesis, and I fell asleep. Because, honestly, it was just boring to me. But when I began to go with her that next day on that Sunday morning, the Lord really spoke to my heart. I can't tell you what the preacher preached on, exactly what the message was. But I remember going out and I thought to myself, you know, I'm going to try and read the Bible again and see what it has to say about this eternal life and about heaven. So I went home and I began reading through the New Testament. I started to read, not one afternoon. But I went home and began to read in the book of Matthew, and I started to read through the New Testament. And I kept an open mind, and I wasn't a Christian yet. But yet, I prayed. I said, Lord, you know, show me from your word. Are these words true? What do they mean? I didn't go back to church that Sunday night, but I went Wednesday, and the next Sunday, and the next Wednesday, and the next Sunday, continued to go. And I remember at that time, one of the things that was a deep conviction on my heart was that my friends and I, we would still go out on the weekends, party or whatever. And yet, as I read the Word of God, I realized that there were two paths in the New Testament that Christ referred to. Those that trusted His salvation and repented of their sins, and those that would walk in their own ways, walk after their own desires. It talks about in Romans, for all have sinned, they've come short of the glory of God. It talks about that there's none righteous, no, not one. And the message of sin, the truth of that, began to impact my heart. And I remember going out with my friends, and as we would go out, I can remember it was like a heavy hand on my heart. As we would go home, realizing that if we were in an auto accident, sometimes my friend would not be in an ability to drive, intoxicated or whatever. And I thought, if we're in an auto accident, I know exactly where I'm going. Because the scripture talks plainly. Christ was warning men of the eternity of hell. And that was like a heavy hand right against my heart. And yet, going to church and hearing the word, and yet still not sure, wanting my own way. But finally, it wasn't very long, just a few weeks, several weeks later, the end of February, the pastor made the altar call on a Sunday morning. Don't know exactly what he preached about. He called for people to come forward. I went forward, and a deacon took me into the back room. He went through scriptures that explained that Christ came to die for our sins. God showed His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. As many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, as many as believed on His name. And I had been reading through the New Testament, and I began to see these verses, that they were true. And I had prayed with that deacon, and I asked Jesus Christ to forgive me of my sins. Desire to help me to turn over my life to Him, repenting of those things in the past and turning towards those things which the scripture teaches, to walk in a way of new life. And so that Sunday afternoon I went home, told my mom, I made that commitment. I prayed and asked Christ to forgive me of my sins. I had my doubts. I went home and I wondered, you know, I never saw Christ. How do I know that He's really heard me? You know, I went forward and made a commitment, but was it really true? But I remember reading in John chapter 8, where it says, Him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. The certainty of my commitment was based in the truth of God's word. He's promised. And what He has promised, the Bible says that God cannot lie. And He saved me from my sins and from the eternal punishment, and gave me the promise of heaven. In the early 80s, I had the opportunity to go to a Bible college, and in Bible college, it was great. I got to be around other people of my age and learn how to serve the Lord, working with inner city kids, or teaching in the Sunday school class, going out witnessing, even tried street preaching one time, where you just go out onto the corner and do street preaching. But it was a real blessing being with other Christians of like faith, my age, a group of people, and to be able to just go to them at any time and say, look, I got a burden on my heart. Let's pray about it. Would you pray about it with me and ask the Lord to meet this need or ask Him to overcome in this area? This was a time when I learned that you can trust in a living God who hears and answers prayer. And it was a real blessing for me at that time. In the later 80s, I had the opportunity to serve in Brazil, South America, and see that how people serve the Lord in other cultures, in another nation. It was interesting. I remember one time when I had the opportunity to speak to a youth group, and I didn't have the language down real good. And what I wanted to say, I told the kids, you know, vamos abrir nossas Bíblias, a pistola de Tiago. What I wanted to say was, let's open our Bibles to the book of James. You know what I said? I said, let's open our Bibles to the epistle of James. But you know, the gospel is the same in whatever language you go into. and it was the same in any other nation. And the truth of God's word, his saving faith, and his saving salvation. In 1991, I had a real blessing. I came into the church here, it was in January, and I attended a Sunday school class here, taught by, I don't know if you know her or not, Ann Krenrick. I went into the Sunday school class, and she was teaching a series about Tony Campolo. Believe it or not, it's hard to believe, but I married my Sunday school teacher. And that was a real blessing to me, to begin a family, and to have a family that you can come home to. Whether you're single or married, the Bible gives the principles of a foundation for your life. It gives the principles of teaching a way that is wholesome, a way that is good, a way that is profitable, how God looks out for us and desires the best for our lives. In closing, I'd just like to share a personal story about our family. You might think this is corny, all right? Sorry, honey. But it's really neat. You know, one of the things that Ann does when I come home, we have a son named Jay. He's about 18 months old. And just about from the time he was born, when we brought him home, one of the things that Ann does is, in our house, you have to go up a few steps to the living room. We always have a baby gate there, you know, so they can't get down. She sits up there with Jay in her lap when I come through the door, and she always says, you know, daddy's home, you know, and we do a little daddy dance home, you know, daddy's home, dance, whatever. And, you know, I know it sounds corny, okay? But, you know, for us, that's really special. It's a family unit. And, you know, as these gentlemen sing about heaven as being our home, we have a Father in heaven who has a great love for us, whether believer or non-believer. But as believers, we have the certainty that we're in this family, that we are able to cry out with our hearts, Father, to the Almighty in heaven. And you know that in the day when we die, the scripture talks about that he will be there at the gates, will appear before the judgment seat of Christ, but that is a place where we enter into our home forever. So if you're here tonight as a Christian, take encouragement in the fact that the Lord God of heaven is your Father. And tonight, if you're here, and maybe this is the first time you've ever heard the witness through the song or word, do you know that you can enter into this relationship as well? Simply by bowing your knee to Jesus Christ and asking him to forgive you of your sins, repenting of them and trusting in his saving salvation, the blood that he shed on the cross for you, that there will be a day when you'll be able to enter into your heavenly home, and with his arms open wide, the Father in heaven will receive you as his son or his daughter. Thank you very much.